Hey, it's Fran, again, in the lab, Fran Lab. And today I'm going to start on a new project that I've actually been waiting a while to do. It's been on my list for about 6 months to do, and it's a little hard to explain exactly what this project is, but it started last year when I was watching videos of one of my favorite bands, Public Service Broadcasting. If you don't know about Public Service Broadcasting, the band, check them out. But I was watching their videos, and linked in their videos was a video that the guitarist and keyboardist, and I guess lead guy from Public Service Broadcasting, J. Will Goose Esquire, was in this video about the Royal Society, and it was called Race for Space, Objectivity Number 32, which I'll link in the description. And in that video, Brady Heron, he also has his blog, which I'll also post in the description, and they show objects from the archives of the Royal Society. And in this video that I was watching, they had space artifacts that the Royal Society has in their collection, and one of the artifacts was this really amazing model of Sputnik. It came in this custom-made case, which they pulled it out of, and has this amazing world Earth base with a little button on it. And it's just a wonderful model that they showed, and it came complete with a schematic, which Brady Heron put on his blog, a little picture of this schematic for what appears to be a working audio model of the Sputnik tone, which would happen if you push the button. It was supposed to make the Sputnik beep in the model, which in fact they actually had so much pride in the design of this little model of the Sputnik that they actually included this functional schematic of the circuit is pretty amazing. And I thought this would be a great opportunity to recover a piece of history, because as they point out in the video, the model doesn't beep anymore. And I thought, wow, what a great idea to recreate this this Sputnik model from 1957. So, for those of you who have never heard of Sputnik, well, you know, if you were like me on October 4th, 1957, if you were busy not being born yet, then you might not appreciate what Sputnik meant to people in the West and in the Soviet Union. But on that day, in October 1957, Americans were filled with a combination of absolute awe and complete dread, because the Soviets had the hydrogen bomb, and now they could put satellites into space. And so we couldn't do that in America yet, and there's just no modern equivalent to the sense of peril that that induced in the American psyche. And Sputnik was small. It was about 58 centimeters in diameter or so, but it was completely polished, shiny, and as it flew over, because it was orbiting, it was orbiting the whole globe, but as the Earth turned, every so many orbits, it would fly over the continental United States. And if you were out at night, if it was within a few hours of either dusk or dawn, as the satellite flew over, you could see the sunlight gleaming off the satellites. You could actually see it with the naked eye going through space. And if you had a shortwave radio, which most everyone had access to back in the day, you could actually pick up Sputnik and listen to the beep that it made as it flew overhead. Really ominous, ominous, and amazing space-age stuff. So I wanted to recreate this model of the model of Sputnik, you know, if you're keen to Hackaday, you might have caught last year they had an article about a guy who recreated the actual Sputnik tube transmitter that was actually in the satellite, Frank Varsenberg. Is that how it's pronounced? My Dutch is terrible. But he recreated the actual transmitter, and apparently, as it says in the article, it transmitted at a dual frequency of 20 and 40 megahertz. So I guess you could pick it up on a shortwave receiver, or if you had a VHF receiver, if you were like a ham and you had a VHF receiver, you could pick up the 40 megahertz signal. I think that the design of Sputnik being tube-based meant that by the virtue of reality, with, you know, you didn't need the high voltage for the plates of the tubes, plus you have to have the power for the transmitter to be able to pick it up, you know, as it flew overhead, you know, I think Sputnik was in a fairly low Earth orbit, but, you know, you have to, as it flies over, you have to pick it up hundreds of miles away, so by virtue of the reality of tube-based transmitters, it would seem that Sputnik would be mostly battery to be able to function for days or weeks. I'm not really sure how long it transmitted, but it was a while. But this model of Sputnik that they have at the Royal Society is based on transistors. Brady Haran had put the schematic that came with the model on his blog, I examined that. It's just kind of barely on the edge of being completely legible, but I kind of made notes based on that schematic and thought, well, this seems like a very doable thing. And I wanted to do it very period correct. So I don't have any 1950s era germanium transistors. In fact, I don't know who would have a bag of Soviet-made 1957 germanium transistors lying around. I'm sure that someone probably does, but I do have quite a large bag of 1960s, mid-60s era Texas Instruments germanium PNP TO5 case transistors. Come on, autofocus, there you go. Well, so these I'm going to use, they're low beta signal transistors, so as far as functionality for a simple set of oscillators, I think these will suffice to be very period accurate for what you would have had, 10 years prior or so. So I think these will work well. And I'm going to go over and look at the schematic, because when thinking about what you would need in a circuit to reproduce the Sputnik beep. Now, I've heard many recordings of the Sputnik over the course of my lifetime, and they're all recorded off of radio transmissions. So the various recordings I've had, and I've actually gone on YouTube and listened to some recordings, and they all vary a lot in pitch and pace as far as the rate of the beeps and the tone of the beeps, and there's lots of things that could be the reasons for that. One is that they're all recorded on different media, and depending on if the signal was recorded on a shellac record or on a wire recorder or a tape recorder, there obviously could be great differences in the record versus playback speed of any of those media. Plus, there's always the tonal shifts that occur with shortwave transmissions because of the atmosphere and everything. If you've ever tried to listen to music on shortwave, you'll know what I'm talking about the tonal shifts. So I imagine that the audio should be somewhere around 1 or 2 kilohertz tone for the correct sound of the beep. And in thinking about how you would recreate the Sputnik beep, it seems that you would need to have an oscillator to make the tone first, and then you would need to have a low-frequency oscillator, an LFO, that would be used to switch the tone on and off to create a beep out of a steady tone, because you have a period to the beeping, which would be determined by a low-frequency oscillator, and then you would need to have an amplifier to drive a speaker. So let's go take a look at the schematic that they provided with the model. So here's the schematic. It's my photocopy of the schematic that was at the Royal Society, and I broke it up into the three basic parts. You have an A-stable multivibrator here for an LFO create the beep, the pulse of the, because the in order to have a beeping sound, you've got an oscillator, and then you have to break up that the output of that oscillator into beeps rather than just having one steady, singing tone. So the LFO would be there to break up the Weinbridge oscillator here, which is creating the tone, to break that up into beeps. And see a little diode here, which is coupling the LFO to the spot here in the Weinbridge, which I imagine is because I guess theoretically, as the LFO is going rail to rail, as it goes to the ground, it would ground out that the signal there, and I guess stop the oscillator from oscillating periodically. But it's definitely the tap-in point. And then got some adjustments here. There's a little trim pot. Let's see if I got a trim pot small enough value for that. But trim pot there for, I guess, the gain is in the feedback here for the oscillator. And we got the output here through a little cap. That's the output of the, so that should be the signal with the beeps, the modulated beeping, to go to the input of the power amp. And I'm assuming that that would be a dynamic speaker. I don't think that this would have like a crystal or piezo element. I think it's got a dual stage output amp here. It's direct coupled. There's like no current limiting on that transistor, so I'm pretty sure that would be a low impedance dynamic loudspeaker. And I have a little speaker that came out of a greeting card that I think might be perfect for this. That's the basic idea. What I want to try to do is actually build this as written, to see if it functions, and go from there. So next step is to go and build it. Alright, so now I have to get to the substitutions, because a lot of the values, the caps in here especially, are not standard. I'm going to have to make them up from other values. The resistors, fortunately, I actually have a lot of these values in stock. There's like five resistors I'm going to have to make up from other values, but not too big a deal. I do have to scrounge up a trim pot. I don't know if I have anything quite that low value, but I think I can scrounge up a multi-turn pot, which will get me down into the sub 1K range, and we can rustle that up. The caps, though, I think it's a bunch of 3 microfarad electrolytic caps in here, which I think would be fairly critical, especially for the oscillator as far as getting the right frequency. And I don't have any 3 mic caps, but I do have tons of these 1 mic caps, so I'm just going to stack them, stack 3 1 mic caps in parallel, give me 3 microfarads. I think these are 10%, so give or take, I'll trim the value, trying to get it as close as I can to 3 microfarads. And I got the transistors, that's the bread and butter right there. Germanium, low beta. They sound very transistor-y. So, and I got a board. Use just a regular breadboard, and put them on, typical breadboard style, as I do. And I think we'll be ready to go. And that speaker, I got this, got some of these. A lot of these from my old greeting card hacks. I've got a bunch of these mini speakers. Mini dynamic speakers. I don't know if this is gonna, well, I imagine that I should have no trouble driving this speaker with this dual output germanium amplifier. So I'm gonna give this one a try. All right, so now I've had to spend some time testing. These Texas Instruments transistors, I've gone through all of them, and just about, I think I found one that wasn't completely leaky, but these are so leaky that I don't think I can really use them for this project. But I also have a bag of these 2N404As. I think they're marked GI. Is that General Instruments? I'm not really sure. I gotta look that up. But these are much better. And I've people are gonna laugh that I still use my Radio Shack multimeter. But I really, the thing that I like about this is it has this transistor tester that, you know, if you don't know the type or pin out of a transistor, if you deal a lot in transistors and you have a lot of new old stock transistors that don't really come up on part searches, you can take the transistor and just plug it in to to the 3-pin socket. If I can align, I gotta straighten out the pins. Hang on. And hit test. It'll tell you the type of transistor, it'll give you the pinouts, the order of the pinouts, and it'll also tell you the beta, which is pretty cool. Does it all in one shot, so you don't have to be tinkering around with leads and figuring out which way the collector is and whatnot. And these transistors arrange a lot. This one's reading around 114. Some of these are actually pretty hot, up around 300 or so. So I've just gone through and I've matched some sets, paired them up to values so that because this circuit it's working in relatively in pairs, so I've picked some pairs, the hottest ones, the ones with the hottest gain, I've picked for the amplifier stage, and the other two I've reasonably matched for the other two oscillators. So I'm fairly confident that this is going to work out. So. Well, here's an inconvenience. At some point, I've managed to magnetize my pliers. very handy that I happen to have many of these sort of demagnetizers, degaussers. I use these primarily for erasing audio tapes. I've got a really big one for reel-to-reels, and I've got a tiny one for demagnetizing tape heads that can get into cassette decks and stuff like that, but this is my kind of medium-sized one and should do a treat. So let's see. We got magnetized pliers. Magnetized, holding onto the lead there. So turn on the bulk eraser. Alright. Ah! Look. And now that. Non-magnetic. It works. Yep. Good old bulk eraser. It's every time. Trying to lay out the components exactly the same way as on the schematic, so it'll be kind of easier to see the final result laid out, because the components will be relatively in the same position on the breadboard as they are on the schematic, more or less. I built up the 3 microfarad caps by stacking up 3 1-microfarad caps and putting them all in parallel, giving me 3. I think I measured these. They're a little over. I think they're like 3.1 microfarads, so they're a little on the high side, but close enough. And I had the 91K resistors, but I didn't have 1.1, but I made up the 1.1K resistors by putting a pair of 2.2s in parallel to divide the value. Wait a second. I put two resistors in parallel and I divide the value, and I put three capacitors in parallel and I tripled the value. Well, that can't be right. Well, it is. I mean, I don't make up the physics, but that's the way it works. When you put capacitors in parallel, you add the value. When you put resistors in parallel, you divide the value. Just the way it works. So don't want to be confusing. That's the way it works. I even, there's a diode in here that's used to pass a signal, and I even have a cool vintage germanium diode in there. Oh, it gets light, yeah, right there. Little vintage germanium diode there, signal diode. Well, okay, so I've got it built up. The oscillators. I didn't build the amp yet, just wanted to test this, and the LFO is working. It's giving a nice steady beating pulse, but the wheat bridge is not. I was looking at the schematic. I mean, I looked up references. I mean, most of my books, I don't even have like a lot of good practical examples for transistor circuits, but I looked up a few examples of functional Wien bridge oscillators using transistors, although I didn't find any that were PNP based. There are a lot of differences between this oscillator and ones that would apparently work in the 1 kilohertz range. It could be that because of the transistors I'm using, that the resistors for the biasing and for the current limiting and such could be just all wrong, and it might be that the transistors are just simply not turning on, or the biasing might be all wrong and they're just not actually turning on to be able to oscillate, or it could be a mistake in the schematic. I could take another design and stick it in there, but that really would defeat the purpose of trying to make this work. So it looks like what I'll probably have to do is just go through the Wien bridge and start tweaking resistor values to see if maybe it is a biasing issue. But also the gain, the trim pot for the gain adjust. Examples I've seen for Wien bridges tend to have that gain adjustment on the first stage, not the second. Yeah, it might be that these values worked perfectly for the transistors that were in the actual display piece, and that I'm probably going to have to adjust these values to get these transistors that I have to oscillate. So yeah, I'm going to tweak the values and see what happens. Yes! It is working! As you can see on the scope that is over my shoulder, it is working. It turns out that there were a number of mistakes on the schematic. I had never actually made a Wien bridge oscillator from transistors before. Least of all antique germanium PNP transistors, but I looked up online a few different working examples. Whoa. And I found, I kind of drew a rough sketch of, you know, of the way the oscillator should be set up, just the basic values and circuit diagram of really how the feedback should work with the for a Wien bridge. And went to the provided schematic and saw there were some things that really didn't make sense. one of the, there did seem to be a proper way for the circuit to feed back on itself to really oscillate to begin with, and I had to change this resistor here to connect it to ground instead of connecting it to the feedback loop to create this more traditional Wienbridge RC arrangement. Yes, Miss Cat. And then I had, and then to get it to oscillate correctly, I had to increase the gain. So these emitter resistors, I had to drop the values down to 100 ohms. I think the this one was like 2.7 and 470 ohms. I dropped those down to 100 ohms apiece and got enough gain. Things start oscillating, and very interesting is how it's oscillating. If you look at the scope trace, you can see it's actually not turning on and off. It's really just sweeping frequency from a low frequency to a very high frequency. So it's very interesting. It's not like an on-off beep. It's more like a weeple. So next step is to build the amplifier stage so we can listen to what this sounds like. Okay, so I'm in like hour 9 of this build, so getting kind of tired, but I finished the circuit with only one modification. I did add a I'll show the notations later, but I did add a little trimmer pot to the amp because I figured this probably might be really loud, so I could attenuate it down a little bit, because the actual model that that they have at the Royal Society is inside of kind of a nice metal base with and they have a little hole drilled in it, which for the speaker. So I wanted kind of to replicate that by putting the little speaker in inside of a container with a hole, similar hole, so I get the kind of same kind of resonance. So I'm using an old Brooklyn box, cardboard box that I just drilled a hole in the top for the speaker and kind of taped the speaker in. And got a switch there to, you know, for the switch, because it's got a push button switch. And figuring that they probably just hooked up the switch to the battery, I've done exactly the same thing, and put the board in there. Yeah, see, and so yeah, I've got the amplifier stage and everything. Interesting thing about the trimmer, the trimmer pot on the Wienbridge, it actually it changing the balance of the circuit. It actually changes the tone a lot, going from like if I turn all the way down towards the ground, it will actually do a beep, like a beep pulse. But as I turn it up, it'll actually do like a pitch shifting thing. I'll show you. But okay, so I'm gonna put the battery and close it up. All right, first time I heard since 1957, perhaps 58. Who knows when the battery went dead in that thing? But here it goes. Okay, so this is what it sounds like going overhead. So let me churn that pot, because it does give some very interesting sounds. If I turn the trimmer, it goes through this range. So, I don't know. I think it's meant to just do the pulse, but it's interesting that you can get that sweep, that two sweep of two sing of a. You can get that sweep of two different frequencies if you turn it up a little bit. It's just kind of neat, but there it is. With some changes, I'm going to make an updated schematic with the corrections. All right, so here is the original schematic that was posted by the Royal Society, and which does not work. And this is my corrected circuit. I substituted some values, some resistor values are approximate, and of course I stacked up capacitors to get approximate capacitor values. Didn't really seem to make too much difference in the performance, but what I did have to do is these two resistors, this resistor here I had to drop down to 100 ohms, and this trimmer I also had to drop down to 100 ohms to get the gain necessary for this to actually start to oscillate. I needed to drop those values. And and here too I made a correction. This resistor here, R17, this 12K resistor, in the original, they have that going to the feedback line, which is going back to the base of the first transistor. And that was an error because that resistor, I brought that down and put that down to ground because tacked here, it has to be to ground for this resistor capacitor combination to work in order for the Wien bridge to actually function. So that's got to be down to ground. And I also moved this line coming off the trimmer for the gain is down here to the feedback line, but I actually took that point, and again to complete the circuit, brought that up to that same tap point there with that RC pair, and that completes the oscillator. Now this capacitor can charge and discharge, and you got your feedback loop, and now it works. And I did add a trim pot here for attenuation on the output because I thought that would be really loud. Turned out I didn't need it. It's not really loud if you're using low gain germanium transistors, so I just actually just left that as stock is fine. So there you go. The corrected working circuit for the Sputnik model, 1957. There you go. So that's it. Success. Thanks to Brady Haran and the Royal Society for that amazing artifact, and even for J. Wilgoose Esquire, who I know will probably want to see this. It's really been a thrill to bring back the Sputnik model from 1957. So anyway, I'm Fran from Fran Lab. Thanks to my Patreon subscribers for making this build possible. You make it happen on Patreon. I'll put a link in the description, and join Team Fran Lab. It's real easy. Just go, click, join. You get a bunch of swag. You help the lab. You make these videos and these projects possible. All right. Well, thanks. See you soon. Bye. It's Fran again in the lab. Fran Lab. Well, a couple weeks ago I did the video about the Sputnik beeper box enclosure, how I made that and came up with the files and stuff, and now it was time to make the prototype printed circuit board for this kit. So now I intend to use my local fab house to make the production boards for the kits, but it's very important to make a prototype board because when you go into like full production, it is expensive, it's a big investment, and if you have any mistakes on the board at all, no matter how minor they might be, from the fit of the board in the enclosure to where the holes for the mounting screws are, or even like lead spacing for a component or something, or even something as stupid as making an error on the board, well, it's very important to make sure that everything is 100% before you go and send it to the fab house to get hundreds of them made. So I decided that I was going to make the prototype boards for the Sputnik beeper box right here in the lab. So it all starts with printing the artwork for the copper one-to-one on using a laser printer, printing on some toner transfer sheets. So I'm using the press and peel blue sheets, and first thing I'm going to do is cut them into individual pieces so that I can align them on the bare copper-clad FR4 boards. It's important to have some kind of a way of taking the sheet off of the board once you've actually got it heat transferred. So I like to leave one end longer than the other. It kind of acts as a tab. I'm going to take some pure denatured alcohol and just wipe off the bare copper clad boards to get any oil or dirt or residue off so that you get a good adhesion with the toner. And I make up a stack. I use a piece of cardboard just as a tray to be able to transport in and out of the press. Put the copper clad board, the press and peel, toner side down, a regular sheet of paper, and then I saturate a piece of heavy cotton material and put that over the top, get the wrinkles out. And the wet cotton, when you put the press down, it's 165 degrees Celsius, so the water that's in the cotton rag turns to steam. And it's really the steam that creates the even transfer of heat through the whole stack and transferring the toner onto the copper. I also find that a little oven mitt is very handy because everything that comes out of the press is super hot and you don't want to touch any of it. I put the copper clad board into a pan of cool water, let it sit a couple minutes till it gets to room temperature, dry it off before I attempt to peel away the toner. This is it's important to make sure that it's cool before you attempt to do this, to make sure that you're not actually pulling the toner up off the board again once you've got it pressed down. And there's that extended tab that I just grab, and nice easy. And there you go. Toner's transferred. Now, first thing I'm going to do is trim down the board because I want to get rid of any excess copper, because the more copper you have on the board, you're just going to be diminishing your chemistry faster. So I'm trimming down the board to actual size before I go to put it in the etchant. This is my high volume, low pressure ventilation system, and I've got it hooked up to my vent hood. And this is in my other video that I made many years ago showing about my home etching process. Now I'm just going to use ferric chloride because I'm only making a few boards here, but if you're making a lot of boards, like dozens of boards, you can do sodium persulfate heated solution, and I have a something on my blog about that if you want to do boards in mass, but I'm just going to use ferric chloride and pour a little bit in the pan, agitation, a little soft bristle brush to remove the gunk that builds up on the board, and the more that you brush it and the more agitation, the faster it's going to etch through. And just check it periodically. You can see through the bottom of the PC board to see if the traces are all etched away. Got a bath of water next to the pan. And taking a look at it, I realized that it's still got a little bit of copper on, so I'm just going to put it back in the etch for another minute. More brushing and a little more agitation. And another wash, and it's done. So now the toner is still attached, and I've got to take that off. So I'm going to clear out my workstation. This ferric chloride is exhausted. I've made a few boards with it. And you don't want to put it down the toilet or put it in the drains. I will put the finished chemistry into a repurposed food container and stow it. And to dispose of this, I mean, you kind of want to get rid of it with your food garbage so that it goes to landfill. You don't want it to go into recycling, and you don't want to put it into the water supply by putting it in the toilet. So I clean the workstation and set up to take off the toner. I'm using nail polish remover, but, you know, if you really are hardcore, you can put the board in a pan of acetone, let it sit for a few minutes, and, you know, scrub it off with a toothbrush or whatever. But whatever method you want to do, results are going to be the same. Just a little bit of elbow grease and some solvent, and take the toner pretty much right off. But now the copper is tarnished and oxidized from the pressing process, so one final step is I'll take it into the sink and just under some cool water with a piece of Scotch-Brite, just scrub off the oxidation and make a nice shiny surface that'll be easy to solder to before I go and drill it. Nice and pretty. So now it's time to drill. Well, I have another blog where I talk about my Accurize drill press. It's a little involved, but get one of these mini drill presses. They're usually too wobbly to use carbide bits, but I had to go through quite a lot of trial and error to shim the chuck with sheets of aluminum foil and stuff like that to eliminate all the wobble to be able to use a high-speed tungsten carbide bit. Yeah, a little bit of patience and a nice slow hand. You notice that I'm very slowly dropping the bit down into the FR4, and this is to find the center of the hole. The copper is much harder than the FR4 board, so if you very slowly enter the bit, it will self-center the hole, and then as soon as you feel the bit catch, you give it a little plunge and plunge the hole through, and you'll get it centered every time. So I've got all the holes for the components drilled out, but I still got to do a little bit more machining. Got to take it to my larger drill press and drill those four larger holes for the mounting screws in the corners. And I got this big hole in the middle for the center post, and well, you know, my large bits are kind of expensive, and I don't have any tungsten carbide bits that are that large, so if you're using steel bits in FR4 board, you will dull them pretty quickly. So I'm just going to use my nibbler. This is kind of a cool tool. People don't really use these anymore, but back in the old days, these were very popular for making your own enclosures, because enclosures were usually made out of sheet metal, and you would have a nibbler like this that you could use to make holes of any size or shape in sheet metal. It also works really good in FR4 board or plastic or pretty much anything. It's basically just a piece of a little die cutter, you know, kind of in pliers form, and every time you squeeze it, it kind of nibbles away a little chunk. But a very effective little tool, a nibbler. And so I just enlarge the hole with the nibbler tool, and then go to regular round file to finish shaping the hole, and it's pretty much done. So here's the printed enclosure, and I actually went and did a mock-up of the printed circuit board from the CAD files, and putting the proto board in there, checked the alignment of the mounting holes. It looks pretty good. One final check with the enclosure to make sure it all fits in and tolerances are good. Seems like a good fit. So now I'm soldering the wires to the speaker and the switch. It's a lot easier to do this before you try to put them in the enclosure than waiting till after. I'm going to put the speaker and the switch in place in the cover portion of the enclosure, and I'm going to just use hot glue, you know, hot snot, just a little bit squeezed in there around the switch, and then a little around the speaker. I can't say I did a good job with this. My hot glue skills have much to be desired, but it did work, so looks gnarly, but it works. And just like before, I'm testing the transistors. It's a good idea to do this if you're using vintage parts because, you know, occasionally you get a bad one. And also the gain varies a lot from transistor to transistor. And so just like the other board I made, I kind of matched sets to make sure that they were paired up. Now it's time to put the components in the circuit board and start with the resistors and work my way up, building up the board from the shortest to the tallest components. After the resistors are in, then I'll put in the capacitors, which are, of course, taller. Put all the capacitors in the board. And then I'll did the transistors last. Now I want all the transistors to be straight and aligned and not kind of in different angles. So to do that, I'm just going to put them all in and just push them into the right height. And then I'm going to just solder one lead on each transistor. So I'm just going to solder the base lead of each transistor. And this will just hold the transistors in place so that they're at the right height on the board. After the bases are soldered, I can kind of align and tweak the angles and make sure they're not crooked. When I see that they're all straight, I can just go in and solder the emitters and collectors, and then it's pretty much all done on the board. There you go. Board's done. So now all I have to do is attach the wires and put the board in place. I have four little screws holding it on to the standoffs, and putting a little wire mount on the top just to, again, to clean the, make the wires a little clean. And kind of arrange the wires, get the top piece on, make sure that those alignment keys are keyed in the slots. Put in the single mounting screw on the bottom. There it is. It's all together. Well, that's it. The Sputnik beeper box is prototyped. It's working. Case works. No rattling. It's, there you go. Had to tweak those resistor values again because for the kits I'm using modern available capacitors, and so the modern standard values are different than what's in the original circuit, so I had to tweak those resistors again just to work around the components that are available. And there might be some variations in the way these perform from kit to kit just based on the variations in the transistors and the gain and such, but anyway, I'm very happy how this turned out. It's ready to go to the fab house to get the kits made. So thanks to all of my Patreon subscribers for making these videos possible. And if you haven't already done so, I urge you to become a member of Team Fran Lab. It's easy to do. You just go to the Patreon, support the lab, get great content. And I'm also gonna put a link in the description for the Fran Lab t-shirts, which are being pre-ordered right now. Make a donation to the lab, you get a shirt, it's a win-win. So, anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll see you soon. Bye. Hey, it's Fran. Again. In the lab. Fran Lab. I want to take a new approach to doing kits, something very modern, because nowadays everybody's got a 3D printer. And even if you don't have a 3D printer, you have access to one. Either you know someone who has one, or you've got a hackerspace somewhere nearby that's, that you can rent time on one. It's it's just about as easy to have access to a 3D printer as a photocopier was like 30 years ago. So I decided that the cool thing to do for DIY would be to make kits where I would do all the hard work right up front. And so you would get a kit that would have the circuit board, the parts, the instructions, and everything. And then it would also have the download instructions. You can download the build files to print the enclosure yourself on your own printer or on a printer that you have access to. And so it really saves with the shipping and such that, you know, if you're not having to ship the enclosure, it also makes it like really super DIY because you're really building the whole thing yourself, including the box. So this is really the whole idea behind FranLab DIY. And the video I did for that project last week did pretty well. Got a write-up in Hackaday. They wrote a really nice article about it. And I'll post the link in the description if you want to go and take a look. But you might have noticed that before I did that video, I hadn't actually posted a video for several weeks. And that's because for about a month, I was deeply involved in an art project. It's a drawing. It's 28 by 32 inches. It's halftone holly. And yeah, 4 weeks. I spent months preparing to do the piece, researching halftone and figuring out ways of doing transitions and trying to come up with standards of drawing dots and squares and transitioning them and looking at halftone photographs with magnifying glasses, and it's just so much work. And I inked the whole thing with fountain pen, and after I'd gotten all the details done, I went in and filled in the big areas with brush, and the whole thing came together, and I was very pleased with the results. Halftone holly, a month of my life, but it's time well spent. I'm very happy with it. It's very satisfying to look at it at the proper distance. So I did go back and refine the circuit for the Sputnik beeper and did a final schematic rendering in ProTel. I ended up keeping the first stage values. I really did need that gain, but I ended up restoring the gain of the second stage, reducing the output to about 50%, and came up with a 450-ohm trimmer resistor for the gain resistor. And basically, this is the finished diagram with the right values and the corrections for the Wien bridge. And with this particular schematic, you have a nice symmetrical, smooth sine output, which when hooked up to the scope and give a listen, we now hear the tone the way it's supposed to sound. Really nice sinusoidal wave. And if I adjust the trim pot, this is the range it goes through now. Sounds pretty good. So now I went to ProTel to do the board layout. I created a template for the board based on the CAD files that represent the standoffs, which are actually printed into the base piece, which are the four holes you see in the corners there, and also that I designed and is for the center support post for the upper part of the enclosure. And the traces here, they're all, because I manually route everything, I just do a single line trace to connect everything the way it should be connected, and then I'll go back later after I've triple checked it for errors and everything and got all the components laid out exactly where I want them, and then I go back and do a final version for the copper, which you see here, and then it's ready. This is just going to be a single-sided board. It's going to be very old school. Now it's time for me to think about the enclosure. And I went back to the original model that's at the Royal Society and thought about how I could make an enclosure that would be 3D printable that would emulate it, but be small enough to fit on in the average, you know, printing bed for a 3D printer, which mine is about 6 inches maximum, so I knew I was going to have to shrinkify it because the original model is larger than that. And also to accommodate a battery and components and things that I wasn't going to do the full sort of partial sphere, but kind of emulate that on top and build it on kind of a raised, shape. So I thought about how everything would fit in. I knew how big the prototype board was that I made, and went to paper and drew out some notes, figuring out about what the shape should be and doing some calculations, just so I can go to AutoCAD and then build up the model. And it's AutoCAD 2000. It's primitive, but it works. It's what I know. And when I had the models made up, I could export them. And then I had to put them into a slicer, which I'm using Simplify 3D, which is a really good program. It's not cheap, but you get what you pay for. There's just so much versatility. You have total control over the whole printing process, and you can go through layer by layer, change everything, the infills, and you know how big the outer shells are, and just everything. I found that it's necessary to print on a raft with any of these large prints. Haven't had any luck in printing direct to the plate on anything this large without having issues with it pulling up off the printing bed. So I added two on the base. I added a nice recessed countersink for the bolt, and which works out pretty well, as you'll see. And again, it's just having the right tools and setup. It's been quite a learning curve with 3D printing for me to get just the right balance of things, to get a reliable print every time. So a lot of tweaking if you have a 3D printer, and every printer is different, so it's like, you know, you just sort of have to work out the problems based on your environment and the kind of printer you have and the kind of setup you have and whatnot. So, but having all of the problems solved, it was time to actually go to print. So here's my setup, and yes, that is a granola box. This looks really ridiculous, but I found it necessary to completely enclose the printer, put plexiglass on all sides, and put this sort of enclosure on the top to create a very stable thermal environment inside the printer. This works really well. I have a little flue cut into the top to regulate the flow of air going through the printer, and it stays at about a constant 93-95 degrees Fahrenheit inside the printer, and this has solved all of my print quality issues that I've had before I built the chimney for the printer. But there we go. There was the top enclosure. I also tried printing it upside down to reduce the build time, but the results were really not favorable. But here we got the finished product with the raft attached. And for some reason, this particular print, I think it's because of all of the supports, the raft was really, really just solidified on there. I haven't had that problem with the other prints, but just something about this particular shape. So had to employ pliers and whatnot to get it going, but some tenacity and some patience. You have to be careful breaking PLA like this, because depending on the filament that you're using, some colors can be more brittle than others, but when you're breaking it up, it can be quite sharp and snappy. And I have cut my fingers and stabbed myself on broken chunks of PLA, so definitely wear eye protection and, you know, be careful. Even though I had the enclosure printed, I still had some machining to do. I had to drill the holes for the speaker and for the switch that I'm going to be putting in later. Important tip too when you're drilling plastic is to build up the hole size. You don't necessarily want to print the final hole size in one shot, but start with a smaller hole and, you know, build your way up with several bits to get the final size that you want, if you want a nice clean hole and if you want it centered. After I had it drilled out, then switched out for a chamfer bit, do a little countersink, and this just takes the burr off of the edge, makes a nice, clean, finished hole, so you don't have any raised edge. You can do it on both sides, and it's always a nice touch to finish a hole with a very slight chamfer. I had the holes drilled, but I also have to tap the center post because I designed it with the idea that it would be held in place with a small 1/4-20 countersunk bolt. So drilling out the hole first, which is smaller than the bolt because you're going to tap it. When you start a tap, you really want to do it with a very light touch. And as the die starts to grab, then you can start driving it in with a very specific kind of motion. You don't want to drive it in like a screw because it's a cutting die, it's cutting. So you want to do a motion like a washing machine. Forward, forward, back, forward, forward, back, forward, forward, back. And this allows the die to cut and also pulls away the debris. If you're doing this in plastic, it's not a big deal, but if you're tapping into metal, it's very easy to get the die jammed if you try to cut into it too fast. But there you go. You know, a nice, smooth tap in the plastic, and grab a bolt and check it out. Make sure that you don't have to do it again, and put that. Nice tap. Done. So while I'm doing all this, I'm printing the base piece, which doesn't take nearly as long as the top. The top has a lot of supports, and I even tried printing the top upside down, but the results were pretty terrible on the finish. So just got a trial and error, really, to figure out what works best for a complicated print. But I did the base in black, just like the original model. And there we go. Done. There's the base piece. 4 hours, 21 minutes. Not too bad. Now getting the printed piece off of the build plate, well, it takes a little finesse. The one thing you want to make sure is that you don't gouge up or bend or dent the build plate, so I use a little plastic tool to assist in getting the stuff off. It also helps to have the patience to wait until the build plate and the printed piece are at room temperature, and then it'll pop off a lot easier. You don't have to really struggle too much. If it's still warm, it's going to really be held on firm, so wait for it to cool. And there you go. Now, this base plate, it removes a lot easier. It just kind of pops off. And again, you got to be careful doing this. Those edges do get sharp when you break them free. So, and wear safety glasses because little pieces fly off and everything. I'm always wearing mine. So, a little care, a little patience, and it'll pop right off. And there you go. Now, I still got a little bit left because there are some supports inside of the countersink, which I have to remove. There they are. Just a pair of needle nose, get in there really easily and pop it right out. No big deal. It's always handy to have some needle nose pliers with the printer. And again, to check this out, first time, look at that. All right, well designed. Tolerance is perfect, and perfect countersink. So here are the two pieces, and all the pieces coming together. You can see the standoffs there that are printed in the base piece. And this is the switch. It's a 7x7 tactile switch, and fits snugly into the little rectangular extension there. And I'll be welding that in place after I get it all wired up and everything in the final. Same with the speaker. A 40 millimeter speaker, it fits inside there as a little raised lip, and that'll get welded in too when it's finally wired up. And the way these two come together, you'll see these raised rails on either side of the switch, and those interface with slots that are on the battery compartment. They serve two purposes. One is, of course, to keep the battery in place so it doesn't rattle around, but they also work to key the two pieces together so when you put the set screw in, the two pieces don't slide around. They're kept in perfect register. So here's the test. This is actually the first time I put it together right here. Get the screw in and, yep, check it. And fits perfectly. There you go. No rattling. Two pieces are firmly held together. And there you go. There it is, the Sputnik beeper box. Very happy how this turned out. It's a good experiment in really how this whole DIY thing can work. I think I'd really like to get your feedback in the comments about what you think about this. And I want to thank all my Patreon patrons who have been making this possible. It's really kind of a cool thing to have Fran Lab up and running properly. And it's the Patreon patrons that make that possible. So thank you. And the next step for this is the circuit board, and I've got that in the works, and I'll be doing those here. I'm going to do the prototypes here, and I'll have a new vlog about that. So that's it. I'll be back. Thanks for watching. See you soon.